when superb is still not good enough.
Marketplace Morning Report is supported by Progressive Insurance. The Name Your Price tool provides a range of coverage options. Progressive.com. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
I'm David Brancaccio. You may have thought it was just a quarterly release of profits and sales from a public corporation, but for people enthusiastic about artificial intelligence, it was like watching a World Cup final. It was the release of spring into summer results from NVIDIA, the firm that makes and sells powerful microchips good for generative AI. The company's been doing fabulously, did fabulously well again, but still disappointed some. And the stock is down 2.4% in pre-market trading right now. Marketplace's Nova Safo has more.
NVIDIA's financial results would be the envy of any company. Revenues were up 122% from a year ago. Compare that to 5%, the amount of revenue growth S&P 500 companies are expected to generate in aggregate this quarter. That's according to the data firm FactSet. NVIDIA's quarterly profit, meanwhile, was around $17 billion. These numbers beat Wall Street's expectations, but not by as much as they have in the past. As a result, NVIDIA's stock price wilted after the company released its results. To make matters worse, if you can call it that, the company forecast revenue for next quarter at about the amount analysts expected. Some on Wall Street appear to have interpreted that as something to worry about. If you're looking for signs that perhaps the AI-inspired stock market rally has gotten ahead of itself. NVIDIA is a bellwether for AI, as it reportedly commands about 80% market share for the types of advanced chips necessary to power those applications. I'm Nova Safo for Marketplace.
NASDAQ futures are up 0.3%. S&P futures are up 0.2% now. And here's a number more than $1 trillion. That's the on-paper market valuation stock price times the number of stocks of Warren Buffett's conglomerate Berkshire Hathaway. Berkshire has all sorts of things, from Geico Insurance to Fruit of the Loom Underwear to Benjamin Moore Paint to See's Candy to the Burlington Northern Santa Fe Railway. Berkshire Class B stock closed up 0.9% yesterday. That's a nearly $500 stock. Class A Berkshire is a luxury item. Just to get one this morning costs nearly $700,000. The founder and boss of the Nearly Anything Goes messaging company Telegram is under official order now not to leave France. Pavel Durov has now been charged for failing to curb criminal activity using his app, allegedly. Durov has sometimes been called Russia's Mark Zuckerberg. The BBC's Zoe Kleinman has more on the charges he faces.
Pavel Durov is a really interesting character. He's sometimes described as the Mark Zuckerberg of Russia. He was born in Russia, but he left the country in 2014. He actually set up a massive social network over there called VKontakte, which is still going. But he left after refusing to comply with the authorities there who wanted information about content that was being shared. These days, he's a citizen of both France and Dubai. And the messaging platform that he founded is called Telegram. It's used by nearly a billion people worldwide. The accusations that he faces include running a platform to enable illicit transactions by an organized gang, refusing to communicate with authorities, and complicity in the organized criminal distribution of sexual images of children. He's under formal investigation in France. He's not allowed to leave the country. But that said, it's still absolutely unprecedented for the owner of a social media platform to be arrested in this way. So it really is a very unusual step for the French authorities to take.
The BBC's Zoe Kleinman.
Marketplace Morning Report is supported by Odoo, designed to save time on business management with one simple user-friendly software, odoo.com, everything any business will ever need. And by Rubrik. When cyber attacks put businesses at risk, Rubrik provides the power to bounce back fast. More at Rubrik.com.
Now to a demographic breakdown on contributions to U.S. economic growth. Today, Latinas, a study finds their contributions to gross domestic product grew by more than 50% between 2010 and 2021. By that last year, totaling $1.3 trillion. This from California Lutheran University and UCLA. Much of that growth comes from the educated daughters of Latinx immigrants. Marketplace's Elizabeth Troval has more.
Though they're just 9% of the population, Latinas accounted for 30% of the growth in the U.S. labor force from 2010 to 2021. And their real income was up 46% in that time.
it is growth that we have been witnessing firsthand and tracking and following for years now.
Jen Auerbach Rodriguez is an executive with Merrill Wealth Management, a subsidiary of Bank of America, which funded this research. She says it's important for financial institutions to recognize that growth.
One in three of every new checking account that we open in the consumer network is opened by a member of the Hispanic Latino community.
But it's important to note why Latinas are making economic gains, like the growth in GDP. Fernando Lozano is a professor of economics at Pomona College.
It can go up either because Latinos are doing better in the economy, or it can go up because there's more Latinos in the economy.
And Lorna Rivera with the University of Massachusetts Boston says a lot of that economic growth is really about the number of Latinas who are entering the workforce, which is happening at a time when
that prime working age group for non-Latinos is declining because they're getting older, right?
Those younger Latina workers play a vital role and will for decades to come.
Because they're also very young population.
Despite their economic rise, Rivera says Latina workers are still overrepresented in certain low-wage jobs.
In like office and administrative support or food preparation, personal care, building and grounds, cleaning.
Latinas earn an average of 57 cents for every dollar a non-Hispanic white man earns, according to UCLA. And Joaquin Rubalcaba with the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, says he's concerned about the transfer of Latina wealth.
I'm not even talking about for immigrants. I'm talking about like second, third generation. Are we going to see that they are able to still continue the upward mobility?
He says it's unclear how much future generations will be able to build on economic gains made by today's Latinas. I'm Elizabeth Trovall for Marketplace.
And I'm David Brancaccio. This is the Marketplace Morning Report. We're from APM, American Public Media.
And when you tune in at 4:30 this afternoon, you'll get a wrap-up of the day's business and economic news. That's coming up at 4:30 on Marketplace here on 91.5 WBEZ. Good morning. I'm Mary Dixon, 5:59 on this Thursday morning. It's August 29th, and coming up, more news. The bacteria that cause Legionnaires' disease have been found in the drinking water at the Metcalf Federal Building in downtown Chicago. That story's coming up.
Hi, I'm Sasha Ann Simons. On the next Reset, is meal prepping a life hack? We'll get a beginner's guide to food planning that could save you time and money. Plus, welcoming back Chicago's Jazz Fest. It's Reset today at noon on 91.5 WBEZ.
Broadcasting from Chicago's Navy Pier, this is WBEZ HD Chicago, 91.5 FM, WBEQ HD Morris, 90.7 FM, WBEK Kankakee, 91.1 FM.
Good morning. Rules dictate the way Americans honor their dead at Arlington. Those rules are at the center of an altercation between cemetery staff and the Trump campaign. We'll hear from a former military chaplain on Morning Edition from NPR News. Close to half the corporate spending at this year's election comes from a single industry. I'm Michelle Martin.
And I'm Steve Inske. Promoters of cryptocurrency are spending millions of dollars in Bitcoin. So what do they hope to gain for the money? Also, why are fake images targeting South Korean women? And we have a way to find the songs of the late Paul Robeson, singer, actor, pro football player, and activist. It's Thursday, August 29th. 80 years ago today in 1944, American troops paraded through Paris, which they'd recaptured from Nazi Germany. The news is next.
Live from NPR News in Washington, I'm Windsor Johnston. Vice President Kamala Harris is scheduled to hold her first campaign rally since accepting the Democratic Party's nomination for president. Benjamin Payne of Georgia Public Broadcasting reports today's event will be held in Savannah, Georgia's oldest city and one of the state's most politically consequential.
Savannah's Chatham County is the largest in Georgia outside of metro Atlanta, with roughly 300,000 residents. Andy Reinertsen is one of them and says he's been more enthusiastic about the race ever since Biden dropped out to make way for Harris.
I think it's refreshing to have a younger candidate in comparison to like the last election and everything leading up to this point. We had to deal with either an 81-year-old man or a 78-year-old man, and that was just not, that's not exciting.
Turnout here could be key to Harris's odds in Georgia. In 2020, Biden won Chatham County by over 25,000 votes. The state was decided by just under 12,000. For NPR News, I'm Benjamin Payne in Savannah, Georgia.
Republican vice presidential nominee J.D. Vance addressed supporters at a rally in Wisconsin last night. Earlier, he took questions from reporters at the event. He was asked about the controversial topic of abortion moving forward.
Each state ought to make their own abortion policy, okay? Wisconsin's going to have a different view than California. California's going to have a different view from Alabama. And what the president has been very clear about is he wants the voters to make those decisions in each individual state.
This is Vance's fourth trip to Wisconsin this month, a state that Republican presidential nominee Donald Trump is trying to flip in November. Trump is expected to campaign in Wisconsin and Michigan today before heading to Pennsylvania tomorrow. UN agencies are preparing to vaccinate more than 640,000 children in Gaza against polio. NPR's Aya Betraoui reports the move comes after the territory's first case of the disease that left a baby paralyzed in one leg.
There are two other suspected cases of polio in Gaza, raising fears of a much larger outbreak already underway. While nearly everyone in Gaza had been vaccinated against polio before the war, the UN says tens of thousands of babies born in the past 11 months and other children were prevented from getting routine vaccines due to constant displacement and the destruction of hospitals. The UN and other aid groups plan to administer the vaccine at clinics in the coming days. The virus was detected last month in wastewater flowing in the streets of Gaza around tents sheltering displaced families, prompting Israel to vaccinate its soldiers from the highly infectious virus. Health professionals say the decimation of Gaza's sanitation and water systems created fertile ground for the virus to spread. Aya Betraoui, NPR News.
This is NPR News.
72 degrees at 6:04. I'm Mary Dixon with WBEZ News. The bacteria that cause Legionnaire's disease have been found in the drinking water at the Metcalf Federal Building in downtown Chicago, where the EPA has its regional headquarters. High levels of lead and copper have also been detected. The Sun-Times reports AFSCME Local 704, which represents 800 EPA workers, have filed a grievance accusing management of failing to take action to provide a safe workplace. In a statement, the EPA regional administrator, Deborah Shore, says the agency is working to fix the problem. The U.S. FDA has approved updated COVID vaccines that will target recent strains of the virus. WBEZ's Haley Bosick reports.
As the summer wave of the virus continues across the country, 2024 to 2025 doses are being shipped out. The CDC is urging those 6 months and older to receive the newest dose. Dr. Alexander Sloboda from Chicago's Public Health Department says for the best protection, people should start to receive annual COVID vaccines, similar to other respiratory diseases.
Kind of think of it a bit like your annual flu vaccine to just get you the best protection, particularly in the fall and winter when people are getting sick from flu, COVID, those viral respiratory viruses.
State and local health officials advise that you consult your doctor if you recently contracted COVID before you get the new dose. Haley Bosick, WBEZ News.
The Chicago Bears' final roster is taking form for the regular season as the team has set its practice squad. 14 of the 16 practice squad slots have been filled by players who were cut by the Bears earlier this week. Hard Knocks fan favorites like Speedo Sporting Karaoke star Theo Benedict, wide receiver Colin Johnson, and quarterback Austin Reed are among those on the practice squad. Head coach Matt Eberflus says Reed impressed him during the preseason.
We just liked the way he operated. I mean, super smart. He performed well in the games, was great in the quarterback room in terms of supporting and being involved and engaged there. And we think he's got a bright future.
ESPN reports the two other spots will go to former Packers receiver Samore Toure and former Patriots defensive lineman Sam Roberts. The Sky lost to the Mystics 74-70. The Cubs beat the Pirates 14-10. White Sox lost two games to the Rangers at home. Weather today, partly cloudy and a high of 86 degrees. Traffic on the inbound Eisenhower, it's heavy Wolf to Harlem, and outbound Eisenhower is solid at Oak Park Avenue. There are at least seven vehicles off to the right shoulder that were damaged after hitting tire debris in the road. Northbound 355 slows near North Avenue with a crash.
WBEZ traffic is supported by Unbound, helping children and families in need. More at unbound.org.
Coming up on Morning Edition, never-before-released recordings of the legendary actor, singer, and civil rights leader Paul Robeson are finally available to the public, and we'll take a listen in 15 minutes on WBEZ.
Support for NPR comes from NPR stations. Other contributors include Procter & Gamble, maker of ZzzQuil Pure Z's Gummies, designed with melatonin for occasional sleeplessness to help people fall asleep naturally. Learn more at ZzzQuil.com. This is NPR.
On a Thursday, it's Morning Edition from NPR News. I'm Steve Inskeep.
And I'm Michelle Martin. Former President Donald Trump shared a TikTok video, including footage that raises questions about whether it violates federal law against using military cemeteries for campaign purposes.
That social media post is the way that he has used images taken amid grave sites at Arlington National Cemetery this week. Trump visited on Monday, and as NPR has reported, Trump campaign staffers had a physical altercation with an Arlington National Cemetery staffer who tried to reinforce the restriction. The campaign is now seeking to downplay that incident.
In a minute, we'll get reaction to this story from a retired military chaplain. But first, NPR's Stephen Fowler is here to talk about the political implications of this incident. Good morning, Stephen.
Good morning.
So Trump was at Arlington Monday for a remembrance of the third anniversary of a suicide bombing in Afghanistan in which 13 U.S. service members were killed. And he posted a video about it online. So just remind us of what the controversy is about.
There's three key things to note about this story, first broken by our colleague Quill Lawrence. One, a pair of Trump campaign staffers had a verbal and physical altercation with an Arlington staffer who tried to stop them from filming in a part of the cemetery known as Section 60 because it's against the rules. Two, federal law also prevents the use of cemeteries as backgrounds or props for political campaigns. Three, the Trump campaign did it anyways, with pictures and now a TikTok video showing Trump and some family members of the deceased posing at headstones.
And what are those family members saying?
Well, in a statement from the Gold Star family members that invited Trump, they say they gave approval for his videographer and photographer to document the emotional moment. It's also important to note the family members who invited Trump also spoke at the Republican National Convention, like Cheryl Jules, who's the aunt of Sergeant Nicole G., one of the 13 service members killed in the attack at Abbey Gate. They used that time on stage to bash President Biden and vocally endorse Trump.
Donald Trump loves his country and will never forget the sacrifice and bravery of our service members. Join us in putting him back in the White House.
So, Michelle, even though they were okay with the cameras, the families don't have the power to suspend the rules. Also, NPR has learned the family of a Green Beret who died by suicide, whose headstone's visible in those pictures and videos, did not give permission to be included, which highlights one reason for the ban on campaigning in such a sensitive environment.
So what has been the Trump campaign's response to this, the information, the reporting about this altercation, other than putting out a video that does seem to be, you know, flouting these rules?
There's been some nastiness in the response. A Trump campaign spokesman said the Arlington representative was, quote, clearly suffering from a mental health episode. And on the campaign trail yesterday, Trump vice presidential nominee J.D. Vance said Vice President Kamala Harris could, quote, go to hell over the Afghanistan withdrawal and blamed reporters for the controversy.
You guys in the media, you're acting like Donald Trump filmed a TV commercial at a gravesite. He was there providing emotional support to a lot of brave Americans who lost loved ones they never should have lost. And there happened to be a camera there, and somebody gave him permission to have that camera there.
He did, in fact, film a commercial there, sort of, which he then put on TikTok.
So obviously we're in the thick of this 2024 presidential campaign. Do we have a sense of how voters might be seeing this or what this adds to our picture of Trump as a candidate and as a once and possibly future commander-in-chief?
Well, Trump's also been accused of calling dead soldiers, quote, suckers and losers, stoked controversy for saying civilian Medal of Freedom recipients are much better than those who received the Medal of Honor. And so all of these things would be a big deal for any other candidate, but this is a perfect encapsulation of life under Trump.
That is NPR's Stephen Fowler. Stephen, thank you.
Thank you.
Now we want to turn to someone who is deeply connected to the experience of supporting service members and their families through loss and grief, and a veteran himself, the Reverend David Peters. He is a retired military chaplain who enlisted in the Marines and served as a chaplain in the Army and the Reserves, including at Walter Reed Army Medical Center, then in Washington, D.C., and he's conducted services at Arlington. Reverend Peters, thank you so much for joining me.
It's good to be here.
Look, any place that a loved one is interred is sacred to them. But if I could just ask you, what's distinctive about Arlington National Cemetery? We often hear Arlington referred to as hallowed ground. For those who haven't been there, why do we say that?
When we use the word sacred and hallowed, we're really talking about a word that has origins in being separate or restricted, literally, quite literally. So we, in order to honor those who have died, we set apart a space that's kind of like a neutral zone for a lot of things, like religious ideology and politics and other things, because we want to honor the way these young people served our country in a time of great conflict.
Now, you've participated in wreath-laying ceremonies at Arlington, and I understand that you've conducted services there, funerals there. Political leaders come to them all the time. You know, how do you keep them from becoming, quote, these ceremonies from becoming, quote, unquote, political?
There's always a tension there, being right there in the heart of Washington, D.C., and with all the people that are coming there for to honor those who have died, but also the staff there that when I was there, I witnessed a very professional staff that worked really hard to keep the flow going of people that are grieving and people that are there to honor the dead, but also to really show that these young people are special for our country and are symbols of hope and courage for the rest of us.
You know, some people might argue you can't tell people how to grieve. And if they want to grieve by bringing, you know, former President Trump, whom they support, to criticize the current leadership, then that's their business. Like, how would you respond to that?
Well, families and friends that grieve loved ones, especially young people that have died, do that in a lot of different ways. And certainly all of us that are veterans have a almost kind of humor connection sometimes to the ones that died. And families do that at gravesides. And there's laughter at funerals sometimes, even in the midst of profound grief. So I don't ever tell people how to grieve or how to do that. But certainly in the sacred ground of Arlington, when the camera comes in, it makes the story a little bit different to outsiders. And so I think grief that is expressed there, even if it's sometimes a little bit comical or joyful, can certainly be misinterpreted when it gets out to the larger community.
And we've learned that, you know, there was another service member whose family members did not appreciate his headstone being seen in this video. And I kind of wonder, you know, how do you sort of balance that? I mean, you know, you have on the one hand a family that wants him there, wants Trump there for whatever their reasons are. And then you've got other family members who are also there in that space, sharing that space, who don't appreciate that. I just wonder, like, how do you sort something like that out?
It's nearly impossible because of the symbolic nature of what these gravestones and the bodies that are buried beneath them mean to us. There's always going to be a tension there about how those symbols are used. And that's why the staff at Arlington, as I got to experience them, are very careful to really focus on what we are here to do, and that is to honor the dead. And that was my role as a chaplain, and all those that work at Arlington have that mission in the foremost of their mind.
We only have 30 seconds left, but do you mind if I ask you what went through your mind when you heard about this incident at Arlington, if you don't mind my asking?
It reminded me of what those graves mean for all of us as Americans, that these young people went far away from their homes to serve their country in this way and give their lives in a sacrificial way. And they should never be exploited for any reason, for any ideology, political or religious.
That is the Reverend David Peters. He is an Episcopal priest and a retired military chaplain. Reverend Peters, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
DC Comics, the home of Superman, is reissuing its style guide.
A style guide for DC Comics. Okay, but why is that news?
Well, fans have wanted for years to have some way to buy this guide to avoid having to scour the internet for rare and pricey originals.
So what is the DC Comics Style Guide? What are we talking about here?
Well, it was created in 1982 to help ensure a consistent look for characters like this one.
I want you to tell all your friends about me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
A few years after the Style Guide came out, we got this Tim Burton blockbuster movie treatment. I believe that was Michael Keaton as Batman. Tom King writes for DC Comics and expects to get his copy of the guide any day now.
Most people in this world cannot tell you when they learn who Batman or Superman or Wonder Woman are. By the time they're three or four, they have an image in their head of who those superheroes are, what they look like. That close your eyes image, the image you've had since before you could remember, is the DC Style Guide.
I confess I mostly care about their outfits for Halloween costume inspiration, but okay, if you say so.
Well, you want to make sure you have authentic costumes, I guess. Now, this style guide was drawn by Jose Luis Garcia Lopez, whom Tom King compares to Italian Renaissance artists.
Christianity was around for a good 1,400 years, but somehow what Michelangelo and Raphael did with those images sort of defined how it exists in our subconscious. You could say Garcia Lopez's effect on comics, like, that's the equivalent.
Now, I'm used to thinking about style guides that apply to, you know, news writing. That's something we would use. So yeah. Why did DC decide its comics needed a style guide?
There's a backstory, because in the 1970s and 1980s, DC Comics was falling behind a rival publisher.
Marvel was like the cool kids.
And DC Comics were stuffy.
And that was the reputation, like, he wore a tie at DC. To sort of get young blood in, DC hired a 28-year-old woman to take over a company that was run by 60-year-old men.
That 28-year-old Jeanette Kahn revamped DC and set the stage for a style guide to make sure that character images stayed consistent, which helps Tom King as he writes DC Comics today.
When I look at that, I was like, that's what I want to capture. Something both fun and transcendent. Superman is smiling. Batman looks sleek. You know, Wonder Woman looks strong. It represents the simplicity of a thing done right.
Back in print. Four decades later. That's great. This is NPR News.
Thanks for following the news every day with Chicago's NPR News Station. This is 91.5 WBEZ. 6:19, it's Thursday, August 29th. I'm Mary Dixon. We're expecting partly cloudy skies today and a high of 86 degrees. Right now, kind of overcast and 72 degrees. We are expecting some more rain overnight and tomorrow. A young woman drops her sexual harassment lawsuit against Northwestern University. That's coming up in the news at 6:30. And later, cryptocurrency companies are the biggest direct corporate donors to political campaigns this year.
It's not the first time that crypto sector has spent a great deal in elections, but the scale of this spending is unprecedented.
More on which candidates crypto firms are supporting and why. That's coming up in 15 minutes on WBEZ.
WBEZ is supported by CertaSun Solar. CertaSun helps homeowners install solar and battery backup and navigate Illinois' solar programs. More at CertaSun, CERTASUN.com/WBEZ.
The Paralympics are underway in Paris, and in one sport designed for visually impaired athletes, part of the team's strategy relies on sound.
You're not thinking about being blind when you're out on the court. It's probably the one space in your life where that just all washes away.
I'm Juana Summers. More on Goalball on All Things Considered from NPR News.
That's All Things Considered after 3 o'clock today on WBEZ.
Celebrating Colombian culture in Logan Square. This is Chicago. This is WBEZ.
Support for NPR comes from this station. And from BritBox, dedicated to helping people discover British crime series, including new seasons of Silent Witness, Blue Lights, and The Responder starring Martin Freeman. Streaming at BritBox.com/NPR. From USPS, dedicated to providing businesses with shipping options. Working to help businesses turn shipping into an advantage with USPS Ground Advantage. Learn more at usps.com/advantage. From Fisher Investments. As a fiduciary, Fisher Investments is obligated to act in their clients' best interest. Learn more at fisherinvestments.com. Investing in securities involves the risk of loss. And from listeners like you, who donate to this NPR station.
It's Morning Edition from NPR News. I'm Steve Inskeep.
And I'm Michelle Martin. Picture this. A celebrity, not just because of one talent, but almost too many to count. The athleticism of a Deion Sanders, the vocal agility of a Nat King Cole, and the charismatic activism of a Harry Belafonte. Paul Robeson had all of that, and it made him a global star.
The gospel trains are coming, I hear it just at hand. Hear the car wheels rumbling and rumbling through the land.
Despite his status as one of the towering figures of the early 20th century, Robeson was almost relegated to the back pages of history. We'll tell you more about that in a minute. But this week, Robeson is back in the spotlight. His complete recordings from 1925 to 1947 are being released to accompany a new book called Paul Robeson, Voice of Freedom. The set features essays by Robeson's granddaughter, Susan, and Shauna Redman. She is a Columbia University professor, and she told me about how and why Robeson became such a cultural icon.
In the 1940s, he was the most famous black man in the entire world, and that for his incredible stardom, but also for his ability to connect with people in ways that they would understand. He had an unwavering commitment to working people's, to the rights to education for people, and so would use those as opportunities to get to the root of what made us all human.
Some wanted freedom and some wanted riches. Some liked to loaf while others dug ditches.
He was born in 1898. His father, as I understand it, was actually an enslaved person. Paul first gets noticed as a football star at Rutgers, and I mean a star, but then he goes to law school. How did he end up becoming a performer?
After meeting his life partner, Eslanda Good Robeson, he was finally convinced to take his turn on the stage and started doing very local theater productions. And it's for his inability to whistle during one of his roles on stage that he was encouraged by the play's director to sing, and that starts his career as a singer.
Sometimes I'm up, sometimes I'm down. Oh, yes, Lord.
His repertoire includes a lot of styles. It includes popular standards, it includes classical music, political songs, but then the spirituals become some of his most powerful recordings.
The spirituals were at the very root of his vocal repertoire. All of the concerns, the stories, the elements of hope and perseverance that ground the spirituals were very, very close to him. These songs represented the best of who African descended peoples were.
Old Man River, that old man river, he must know something. Don't say nothing.
I want to talk about Old Man River. He became world famous as Joe in the 1920s in this musical Showboat with his version of Old Man River. But he had a kind of complicated relationship with it, and at some point he kind of made it his own.
The kinds of language that was written into that song with proficient use of the N-word, he understood that he was going to have to reconfigure that song if it were going to continue in his repertoire. So he changed the song to match not only more contemporary representations of blackness, but also more contemporary concerns around war and around resilience and resistance. And so the song is forever attached to him because he made it uniquely and powerfully his.
I'm tired of living and feared of dying, but Old Man River, he just keeps rolling along.
His recording career essentially ground to a halt in 1948. Why did that happen?
So he offered a speech at a peace conference in Paris This was at the moment of the height of a second Red Scare, where the threat of accusation of communism was felling entire careers. He becomes state's enemy number one. The press has turned against him. His established concert dates are canceled. His recording contracts are canceled. His passport is revoked. And of course, it's during this period that he offers multiple famed concerts where he sings across the U.S.-Canadian border as a means of refusing the restrictions of the State Department on his travel.
That is kind of crazy. Just set the scene for us. He literally stands and sings across the border, basically.
So in the early 1950s, he's invited to come to Canada. He stopped at the border, and rather than turn back and head back home, they decide that they're going to offer the concert anyway. And from the bed of a pickup truck, Paul Robeson sings via microphone to those thousands of people amassed on the other side. He made a comment to his friend, Harry Belafonte, who identified himself as a disciple of Paul Robeson. And he made a comment to Harry, "Get them to sing your songs and they'll want to know who you are."
"Takes more than guns to kill a man," says Joe. "I didn't die."
Why do you think it is that he is not better known, given what an enormous celebrity he was?
I think it's plainly and simply because he was dangerous. He was singing to people, which made his language, which made his political positions so much more enticing, so much more beautiful and easily received for people. And that's dangerous for those systems of power and influence. But people still carry his name. There are still streets named after him. People are still listening to his voice. People are still wanting to be in a community where Paul Robeson lives.
The collection is called Paul Robeson, Voice of Freedom. Professor Shauna Redmond, thanks so much for talking with us today.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows my sorrow.
This is NPR News.
And this is Morning Edition on Chicago's NPR News Station. It's 91.5 WBEZ. I'm Mary Dixon. It's 6:29. It's Thursday, August 29th. And still ahead, it's happening in schools here and around the country. They're banning students' cell phones during class. How it's working at one school in Colorado at 6:45. Traffic, the inbound to Edens is heavy from Peterson to the junction. The Kennedy is slow from Harlem to North Avenue. On the upbound Eisenhower, at least seven vehicles are on the shoulder near Oak Park Avenue. They hit tire debris. There's a 10-minute delay back to Cicero. More news is coming your way from NPR and the WBEZ newsroom. Stay with us.
Live from NPR News in Washington, I'm Dave Mattingly. The European Union's top diplomat is urging Ukraine's allies, including the U.S., to allow Ukrainian forces to use long-range ballistic missiles against Russia. Josep Borrell has been meeting in Brussels today with Ukraine's foreign minister, Dmytro Kuleba, who says nobody should blame Kyiv if Ukraine fails to defeat Russia's invasion.
The success of Russia depends on one thing, on the preparedness of partners to make bold decisions. If decisions are taken, Ukraine is successful on the ground. If they're not taken, then do not complain on Ukraine, complain on yourself.
Tech billionaire Pavel Durov is facing formal charges in France. He was arrested this week at an airport outside Paris. As Rebecca Rossman reports, Durov was indicted yesterday on multiple counts related to his messaging app Telegram.
They're mostly tied to allegations that Durov was complicit in the spread of all kinds of illegal activities on Telegram. Things like the spread of child sexual abuse materials, drug trafficking, and money laundering. French investigators say Durov failed to cooperate with them or provide information that would have helped them shut down these illegal operations. And he's now under judicial supervision and is banned from leaving French territory.
Durov founded the messaging app in 2013. This is NPR News from Washington.
71 degrees at 6:31. I'm Mary Dixon with WBEZ News. A cheerleader has dropped her federal sexual harassment lawsuit against Northwestern University. Hayden Richardson filed suit in the Northern District of Illinois in 2021. She alleged drunken fans and alumni groped her at school-sanctioned events in 2018 and 19, and that administrators tried to cover up her complaints. She also alleged the cheerleading coach at the time required female cheerleaders to mingle with powerful donors to help bring in more money. Online court records show Richardson agreed to drop the lawsuit Monday. A judge approved it a day later. The records don't indicate why. Northwestern's attorney did not immediately return a message seeking comment. The Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum in Springfield is making more than 1,000 Lincoln-era photos available for free online. As WBEZ's Alex Degman tells us, the public had never seen most of these.
The pictures have been digitized and enhanced, and until now, only researchers have seen them. They include portraits of Lincoln, some younger, some with a beard and others without, and others with his signature top hat. There are also photos of Lincoln's family into the 1900s. Hundreds of photos show renovations to Lincoln's tomb in the early 20th century, including crews moving his casket in 1901. There are also dozens of photos of Lincoln's assassination. The museum says the Illinois State Library awarded a $100,000 grant to the project and is hosting it in its digital archives. Alex Degman, WBEZ News.
Local talk radio host Amy Jacobson has resigned as head volleyball coach at Amundsen High School in the city's Bowmanville neighborhood. Block Club Chicago reports parents called for her to step down after she mocked the 17-year-old son of Democratic vice presidential nominee Tim Walz on the air. In an email to parents, Amundsen officials said Jacobson was no longer part of the school's athletic program, effective immediately.
WBEZ presents Focalo's summer finale on Friday, September 20th. Join us at Jay Pritzker Pavilion for an unforgettable evening featuring performances from Pivot Gang, Marquise Hill, Kaina, and more. Learn more at WBEZ.org/events.
WBEZ is supported by Architect of Chicagoland. Since 2004, Architect has been providing custom-designed outdoor living spaces for Chicagoland families, including decks, patios, porches, and outdoor kitchens. More at architect.com/Chicagoland.
And from National Geographic Lindblad Expeditions, committed to connecting travelers deeper into the wonders of planet Earth, from Antarctica to the Galapagos Islands. More at natgeoexpeditions.com/cruises. From Insperity, providing HR services and technology, from payroll, benefits, and HR compliance to talent development. Learn more at Insperity.com/HR Matters. And from listeners like you who donate to this NPR station.
It's Morning Edition from NPR News. I'm Michelle Martin.
And I'm Steve Inskeep. Good morning. Cryptocurrency companies have been spending to promote their enterprises. The value of crypto rises and then crashes, then rises, then crashes, then becomes the center of a scandal, and then goes on. And amid it all, promoters have been buying celebrity-filled Super Bowl TV ads for crypto. They've been buying naming rights for arenas, and now they're trying to buy candidates in elections. Or, put more politely, donating to a public cause. The consumer advocacy group Public Citizen says almost half of all corporate money contributed to this year's campaigns, almost half, has come from crypto backers. Rick Claypool wrote that report and spoke with Layla Fadel.
The scale of this spending is unprecedented. I mean, it's not the first time that crypto sector has spent a great deal in elections. The former CEO of FTX, now a convicted felon, Sam Bankman-Fried, was a very prolific contributor to elections over the past couple of cycles. But that was on an individual level and not at the scale that we're seeing now.
Are they spending across the board, depending on candidates' policies? I mean, where's the money going?
So that's part of what's unique about what the crypto sector is doing, is saying we are just going to amass this huge super PAC pile of cash, and we are going to spend that toward candidates who we think will advance the policies that we like, regardless of party. They have already been intervening in the primaries. Largely, they spent $10 million against Katie Porter in her primary in California. They spent millions against Jamal Bowman in New York. And they also spent millions backing Jim Justice in West Virginia. Hmm. Now they have pledged that they're going to support 18 candidates for the House, 9 Republicans and 9 Democrats. That has infuriated people on both sides, but it's been a strategy that has resulted in lawmakers softening their positions.
So aren't they just doing American politics? I mean, when you think about the ways that pharmaceutical companies, insurance companies, I mean, different organizations that have one issue in mind, pay into politics to get influence.
This is part of the core of the Citizens United problem, right? So Citizens United was a 2010 Supreme Court ruling that allowed unlimited spending by corporations as long as they're not coordinating directly with candidates. And that gave rise to these vehicles like, you know, super PACs, which just can, you know, amass these funds and then spend them for, you know, candidates.
How do you anticipate this type of political contribution, this scale of money directly from corporations like these, impacts these elections? And how does that evolve over time?
Well, every corporate sector is watching this. I mean, this is a different strategy than what we have seen other corporations engaging in. And the success means that this could well be duplicated by any corporate sector, whether it's the, you know, fossil fuel companies or pharmaceutical companies or insurance companies. You know, right now they are really taking advantage of the great deal of leverage that they have because of the very slim majorities in the, you know, the House and Senate. And they're using it. And in doing so, they're doing real damage to our democracy.
When you say could destroy the democracy, what does that mean?
Yeah, I mean, it's doing great damage because instead of saying, well, we're going to help elect Democrats or we're going to help elect Republicans, they are just saying we're going to organize this super PAC that is solely about advancing the interest of crypto corporations. We're going to raise over $100 million from crypto corporations, and we're going to let this loom over the election like a corporate death star that says, okay, if you are going to advance the policies that our sector likes, we're going to help you. And if you take positions that we oppose, we're going to try to end your political career.
Mm. A small group of people with a lot of money manipulating elections.
Indeed.
Rick Claypool's recent report from Public Citizen is titled Big Crypto, Big Spending. Rick, thank you for your time.
Thank you, Layla.
South Korea has some of the world's most advanced digital technologies. It is also, like many countries, grappling with digital sex crimes, most recently the spread of deepfake porn. NPR's Anthony Kuhn has this report from Seoul.
The overwhelming majority of the victims of deepfake porn in South Korea are women. They often share a common and traumatic experience. They go online and see fake sexual images that have been altered to include pictures of themselves, which were used without their consent. At a cabinet meeting this week, President Yoon Song-yeol mentioned another troubling aspect of this trend.
Many of the victims are minors, and most of the perpetrators are also revealed to be teenagers.
Yoon ordered a police crackdown on deepfake porn, which began the following day.
Some people say it is a simple prank, but it's a criminal act that exploits technology while relying on a shield of anonymity. Any of us can become a victim of such digital sex crimes.
But very few people convicted of digital sex crimes in South Korea do jail time. Most get off with a fine and or a suspended sentence. Chang Dahe, a research fellow at the Korean Institute of Criminology and Justice in Seoul, explains part of the problem.
In many cases, judges think the damage is not as severe as in sexual violence involving direct physical contact.
Many of the deepfakes have been shared on the messaging app Telegram, whose CEO was indicted Wednesday for alleged illegal activity on his platform. Chang says that some men make or spread deepfake porn to take revenge on women they think have disrespected them. Sometimes they're out to make money, but often, she says, it's just straight-up bullying.
For most of the people who consume and share this content, the goal is to belittle women. And this is related to the culture of gender conflict and sexual discrimination in Korean society.
In his comments about deepfake porn, President Yoon Song-yeol called for the creation of a healthier online environment. He did not mention the issue of structural discrimination against women, which he has previously argued does not exist. Anthony Kuhn, NPR News, Seoul.
Okay, Michelle, I'm looking forward to this. We had a conversation with RZA, or the RZA, depending on your preference. Robert Diggs, the amazing hip-hop artist and musician, multi-talented guy, who has now composed classical music for a ballet. So we're going to hear that conversation tomorrow. It's kind of suspenseful because I haven't finished editing the story yet.
Well, I can't wait. Why don't you get to work?
I'll do that. This is NPR News.
Thanks for listening to Morning Edition on Chicago's NPR News Station. It's 91.5 WBEZ at 6:42 on a Thursday morning. I'm Mary Dixon. Busy sporting day for Chicago fans. The Sky lost to the Mystics 74-70 at Wintrust. Chicago rookie Angel Reese grabbed 14 rebounds, her 24th consecutive game with double-digit boards. The White Sox lost 2 to the Rangers on the South Side. The Rangers won game two, 4-3 last night, and 3-1 hours earlier in the resumption of that game suspended by rain Tuesday night. The White Sox are 31-103. The franchise record is 106 losses in 1970. Cubs rallied to beat the Pirates 14-10 and swept them in Pittsburgh. This afternoon, the White Sox host Texas. The Cubs are off. Tomorrow, the Sox host the New York Mets. The Cubs are in Washington tomorrow, and the Sky are due to host the Indiana Fever, and it's Barbie night.
Calls are growing louder to ban the sale of energy drinks to those under the age of 16. Next time on 1A, we hear more about this caffeine craze and how it's affecting our kids. This morning at 10, here on 91.5 WBEZ.
Hi, I'm Sasha Ann Simons. On the next reset, is meal prepping a life hack? We'll get a beginner's guide to food planning that could save you time and money. Plus, welcoming back Chicago's Jazz Fest. That's Reset today at noon on 91.5 WBEZ.
Taking a look at traffic, the Eisenhower is a mess. It's an hour inbound from Route 390 to the old post office. And outbound, crews have gotten the tire debris out of the road near Oak Park Avenue, but there are at least 7 vehicles on the shoulder that were damaged by the tire debris, so it's solid on the outbound Eisenhower back to Pulaski. WBEZ traffic is supported by Unbound, helping children and families in need. More at unbound.org. WBEZ is supported by Navy Pier. Chicago Live returns to Navy Pier on September 21st and 22nd, featuring 111 back-to-back musical, dance, theatrical, and cultural performances. Learn more at navypier.org.
Support for NPR comes from this station and from Bank of America, offering access to resources and digital tools designed to help local to global companies make moves for their businesses. Learn more at bankofamerica.com/bankingforbusiness. From Indeed, designed to be an end-to-end hiring solution for businesses of all sizes to attract, interview, and hire candidates all from one platform. Learn more at indeed.com/NPR. And from listeners like you, who donate to this NPR station.
It's Morning Edition from NPR News. I'm Michelle Martin.
Oh, sorry for the delay, Michelle. I was looking at my phone, which is relevant to this story because public schools are moving to restrict how students use their phones. Florida banned cell phone use in schools statewide last year, and this school year brings bans in my home state of Indiana and Los Angeles, among other places. So what is that like for teachers, administrators, and students? Rachel Cohen from the Mountain West News Bureau reports from a school in Colorado.
It's the third day of school at Doherty High in Colorado Springs. 1,700 teenagers file through the doors as security guard Lonnie Barrett checks IDs.
Good morning, thank you.
This year, he's also inspecting cell phones.
Can I see your phone?
According to a new policy, students are given special pouches to keep their phones in all day. Barrett checks each one.
What is this? This isn't a phone. This is a box of extra gum. How much you want to bet?
Barrett says this happens a few times each morning.
They'll put like empty cases or even an old broken phone that doesn't even work anymore. They'll try to put that in there and sneak it past us. So it's been entertaining.
Principal Hillary Heinton explains the gray fabric pouches designed by a company called Yonder magnetically lock. Students unlock them at a magnet station at the end of the day.
And so you just hit one on the side of the Yonder pouch to the magnet.
The district spent more than $300,000 on 11,000 pouches for middle and high schoolers. Heinton says after students came back from learning at home during the pandemic, rampant cell phone use reached a point where something had to be done.
In classrooms, it turned into a lot of power struggles. Students didn't want to put their phones away or give up their phones.
She also says research shows social media and cell phones can be harmful for youth mental health.
This is the best policy change we've ever made in my career of 28 years.
Jim Foudy is a superintendent of a small school district in Idaho that banned cell phones last year. He says it's gone smoothly.
We actually hired a teacher who had a few different job offers and said that he chose to work for Blaine County because this policy was in place.
Doherty High School English teacher Aaron Onfelt says he feels like he did when he began teaching before smartphones were everywhere.
I think it's a courageous move.
In the first week, he's already noticed a difference. Last year, when he gave students a break between lessons, they'd pick up their phones.
And then this year, every time I give them a 5-minute break, they just talk to each other. So then that makes the feel of a community in a classroom way more powerful.
I hate this new phone system a lot.
Eli Howard is a junior. He doesn't think the policy will make students pay attention in class, and he worries about safety. Earlier in the morning, the school was put on a hold during a potential emergency. It turned out to be nothing, but Howard was scared.
Like, I was like, dude, what if there's someone in here and I can't, my mom and dad, I can't talk to them?
Some parents also worry about reaching their children in emergencies. Principal Heinton has this answer when students ask why the school is doing this to them.
I say I care about you and I care about your education, and I want to make sure that you have the tools and the skills and the competencies that are going to make you successful in life.
She says phones are a distraction from that success. For NPR News, I'm Rachel Cohen in Colorado Springs.
This is NPR News.
And this is Morning Edition on Chicago's NPR News Station. This is 91.5 WBEZ. I'm Mary Dixon at 6:49 on this Thursday morning. Coming up in the news at 7 o'clock, it's time for Illinois residents to submit their ideas for a new state flag.